medicine, so had the cure. The bark of the cinchona tree, which native people had long used to treat fever, was the cure. It was only natural that they would use it to treat this new disease, and it worked. It wasn't until much later in 1820 the French scientists discovered how to extract the active ingredient from the bark, quinine. According to the BBC, a popular story claiming that it was a Spanish nobleman who discovered it could be used to treat malaria has been widely debunked. One thing is certain, it was a huge deal. It saved so many British lives throughout the 19th century that it was regarded as one of the tools of imperialism that enabled the British Empire to colonize malaria-infested areas such as India. It was not replaced as a malaria treatment until the 1970s, by which time it had saved an unimaginable number of lives, and it had a major global impact. Number two, Mayan ruins at Palenque. Father Pedro Lorenzo de Granada, a Spaniard, published the first account of this lost city in 1567. He discovered the stone temples and plazas near the Usumacinta River in the modern Mexican state of Chiapas, which were originally decorated with blue and red painted stucco that had long been abandoned by the Maya who built them. Lorenzo named the massive structure Palenque, which means fortification in Spanish. Palenque, one of Mexico's most visited archaeological sites, is a modern wellspring from which researchers have drawn some of the most detailed information about Maya culture 500 years later. According to experts, it was not large, being dwarfed by cities such as Calakmul and Tikal. David Stewart at Harvard's Peabody Museum reported in 2003 that Palenque could only support 6,220 people at its peak. However, Palenque is famous for something else. Michael D. Carrasco, an assistant professor of art history at Florida State University, explained that Palenque wasn't known for its size or age. Its other sites are much larger and much older. Its significance stems from its naturalistic sculpture, architectural inventiveness, and meticulous epigraphic record. Palenque's wealth of epigraphy, inscriptions, and recorded history has assisted archaeologists in constructing the first timeline of Mayan rulers. One that, while impressive, is still a little hazy in places, so there's a lot more work to be done. Number one, the ancient Inca figurines. The small golden figurines that once belonged to the Incas are so similar to modern-day aeroplanes that they continue to astound researchers even today. The question of whether these ancient forms actually depict an actual prototype remains unanswered as well. The Incas inhabited South America, with the largest tribe residing in what is now Colombia's province of Tolima. For hundreds of years, the area was inhabited, but it was also the site of the discovery of the first aeroplane figurines, which scientists estimated to be 1,200 to 1,500 years old. The Incas may have used them as nose and ear decorations, but the big mystery is why they look so much like modern aeroplanes. In 1969, Emanuel Staub, an American jeweler, gave the winged figurine in his possession to his friend, Ivan Sanderson, a well-known zoologist and the head of the Society for Study of Unexplained Phenomena. Sanderson consulted several aviation experts who explained that the figures perfectly match models of flying aircraft. Similar figurines have been discovered not only in Colombia, but also in Venezuela and Peru. But why did they design them so specifically? If they existed, where did all these planes go? Jungles have been a massive source of information and mysteries about the planet, but there's a lot more research necessary before we can feel we've actually learned it all. We don't even know if that's actually possible. Scientists have discovered the mysterious mounds in the southwest corner of the Amazon basin were once the site of an ancient urban settlement. Beginning somewhere around 1500 years ago, ancient Amazonians built and lived in densely populated centers surrounded by kilometers of elevated roadways. The complexity of these settlements is mind-boggling, according to team member Heiko Krumers, an archaeologist at the German Archaeological Institute in Berlin. Jonas Gregorio de Souza, an archaeologist at Barcelona's Pompeu Fabra University, also added that this was the first clear evidence of urban societies in this part of the Amazon basin. The study adds to a growing body of evidence that the Amazon, long thought to be a pristine wilderness before Europeans arrived, was home to advanced societies long before that. Humans have lived in the Amazon basin for around 10,000 years, where a vast river drainage system roughly the size of the continental United States also exists. Prior to the arrival of Europeans in the 16th century, researchers believe that all Amazonians live in small nomadic tribes with little impact on the world around them. While early European visitors described a landscape densely packed with towns and villages, later explorers were unable to pinpoint these locations. Archaeologists have yet to confirm the rumors by the 20th century and argued that the Amazon's nutrient-poor soil couldn't support large-scale agriculture, and that it would have prevented tropical civilizations similar to those found in Central America and Southeast Asia from arising in the Amazon. But by the 2000s, archaeological opinion was beginning to shift. Some researchers theorized that the potential presence of seven domesticated plants in the area, as well as areas of nutrient-rich soil, humans had once lived in different places. To put it plainly, it shaped the very environment of the Amazon. The theory gained even further support after archaeologists reported hundreds of large geometric mounds discovered due to deforestation in the southern Amazon rainforest in 2018. These structures suggested ancient, organized societies capable of thriving in one location for years and no depth existed there. But there was no direct evidence of settlements. However, Prumas began researching a group of mounds in the Bolivian Amazon Basin outside of the dense rainforest in 1999. Previous excavations have revealed that these forest islands had human habitation, including the mysterious Casanare culture, which appeared around 500 AD. During one excavation, Prumas and his colleagues discovered what appeared to be a wall, indicating that the area had once been occupied by a Puerto Rican settlement. The researchers also discovered graves, platforms, and other evidence of complex society. However, the dense vegetation made it difficult for them to survey the site using traditional methods. By the 2010s, archaeologists were enamored with a LIDAR, a remote sensing technology that uses lasers to generate a 3D image of the ground below. A LIDAR survey of Honduran Valley in 2012 aided in the rediscovery of an ancient pre-Columbian city, thought to have existed in the area. The jungle had completely overtaken the settlement since it was abandoned in the 15th century, making aerial viewing nearly impossible without LIDAR. In 2019, Prumas and his colleagues decided to use LIDAR and fly a helicopter equipped with the technology over six areas near sites that were confirmed to be occupied by the Casanare people. The team have got more than they bargained for, with LIDAR revealing the size and shape of 26 settlements, including 11 that researchers weren't looking for. A massive task that would have taken 400 years to survey using traditional methods, according to Prumas. Two of the urban areas were larger than 100 hectares, three times the size of the Vatican City. The LIDAR images revealed a walled compound with broad terraces rising 6 meters above ground level. Urban pyramids towered above one end of the terraces. Beyond a shadow of a doubt, people most likely lived in the areas surrounding the terraces and traveled along the causeways that linked the sites. Prumas explained that for some reason, the world had this mental image of Amazonia as a green desert. There was no proof of that, so why shouldn't something like that exist in the forest? But while we have answers to some questions, many remain unanswered. It is still unknown why these settlements were abandoned after 900 years. The Casanare vanished around 1400, according to radiocarbon dating. According to Prumas, LIDAR images revealed reservoirs in the settlements, possibly indicating that this part of the world wasn't always wet, which indicated an environmental shift that may have driven people away. Consistent pollen records, on the other hand, show that maize, also known as corn, had grown in the area for thousands of years, which further indicated sustainable agricultural practices. The discovery of long-lost Amazonian societies changed the general perspective people have of Amazonian archaeology. According to Eduardo Neves, an archaeologist at Brazil's University of São Paulo, he believes that current logging and farming in the Amazon basin are almost certainly destroying important archaeological sites that have yet to be discovered, but the growing interest in Amazonian archaeology may lead to the protection of vulnerable areas. These findings also refute the popular belief that indigenous peoples were passive inhabitants of the Amazon basin prior to the arrival of Europeans. The people who lived there forever changed the landscape. Of course, their contributions should be preserved in our history. And if you thought this discovery was surprising, well, you're in for a treat. Archaeologists found a vast network of Amazon thousand villages laid out like the cosmos. Billions of lasers shot from a helicopter flying over the Brazilian Amazon rainforest and detected a vast network of long-abandoned, circular, rectangular-shaped villages dating from 1300 to 1700, according to another new study. The round villages all had remarkably similar layouts, with elongated mounds circling a central plaza like marks on a clock. The researchers explained that when seen from above, these latter elongated mounds looked like the rays of the sun, which gave them the common name of Açores, the Portuguese word for suns. The Amazon finally gave up its secrets after many years of studying and confirmed that civilizations in the millions once thrived in the area. And while that may be a surprise, there's one thing we've always known about the rainforest, which is that it's home to millions of species apart from humans. So of course, they stumbled across a fossil that helped to get 50 million years of missing data. The remains of the smallest fossil monkey ever discovered have been discovered by a team of Peruvian and American scientists. The fossilized tooth discovered in Peru's Amazon jungle has been identified as belonging to a new species, hamster-sized monkey. According to a team led by Duke University, a national university here in Peru, the specimen is significant because it bridges a 15 million year gap in the fossil record for New World monkeys. The new fossil was discovered in southeastern Peru on an exposed riverbank along the Rio Alto Madre de Dios. Researchers excavated sandstone and gravel chunks, placed them in bags, hauled them away to be soaked in water, and strained through sieves to extract the fossilized teeth, jaws, and bone fragments buried within. And sure, it was hard work. The team combed through 2,000 pounds of sediment containing hundreds of rodents, bats, and other animal fossils before discovering a lone monkey tooth. But their patience paid off a big time. The first author, Richard Kay, a Duke University professor of evolutionary anthropology, who had been conducting paleontological research in South America for nearly four decades, stated that primate fossils are not easy to come across. The specimen, a single upper molar, was at double the size of the head of a pin, could fall through a window screen. If you're wondering why a tooth could have caused such excitement, it's because monkey teeth, particularly molars, can reveal a lot to paleontologists. Based on the relative size and shape of the tooth, the researchers believe the animal ate energy-rich fruits and insects and weighed less than half a pound, only slightly heavier than baseball. That's tiny compared to some of South America's large monkeys, such as howlers and muriquis, which can weigh up to 50 pounds. Kay explained that it's by far the smallest fossil monkey ever discovered anywhere on the planet. Only one living monkey species, the teacup-sized pygmy marmoset, was smaller than only barely. The team named the animal Parmico matadai, or tiny monkey from mother gorilla, in a paper published in the Journal of Human Evolution. The discovery, which is now housed in the permanent collections at Peru's National University of Piura's Institute of Paleontology, is significant because it's one of the few clues scientists have from a key missing chapter in monkey evolution. Monkeys both have arrived in South America from Africa 40 million years ago, rapidly diversifying into the 150 plus New World species we know today, the majority of which live in the Amazon rainforest. But how that process played out is a bit of a mystery, thanks in part to a gap in the monkey fossil record between 13 and 31 million years ago, with only a few fragments that just haven't been enough. Parmico lived in that void. The new fossil dates back 17 to 19 million years, putting it smack dab in the period when researchers would have expected diversification in the New World monkeys. The Parmico may have been new to researchers, so of course its discovery was exciting, but the Amazon is also giving us new details about animals we know exist today. For instance, electric eels were seen to have hunted in packs in the Amazon rivers. And up, darkness comes, electric eels emerge from South American river bottoms to attack their prey with up to 860 volts of electricity, enough to kill a person. Now scientists have revealed that the snake-like fish don't always go it alone. They hunt in packs, similar to wolves, orcas, or some species of tuna. The finding, a first among electric fishes, may open the way for new studies to investigate when social predation evolved among fishes. Douglas Abasto, a biologist at the National Institute for Amazon Research, first saw a group attack in 2012, was shocked. Usually, eels, which can grow growth as long as a broomstick, weigh up to 20 kilograms, prey alone at night, targeting single resting fishes he nuts. This behavior is unusual not only for freshwater fish, but also for electrical eels. Bastos witnessed the attack on an expedition looking for endangered fish in northern Brazil. 2 years later, he went back for a closer look. Camping alone in the middle of the Amazon, 5-day journey by boat from the nearest city, Altamira, he filmed hundreds of electric eels in groups of 10, reportedly attacking small tetra fishes on the Iriri River, a tributary of the Indi River, which is a tributary of the Amazon River in northern Brazil. The eels were electrophorous and volatile, which delivered the strongest shock ever measured in a living animal. So far, the group attacks have only been recorded in the low water season, which runs from June to November. During these months, which see a significant reduction in rainfall, fish in the region's rivers squeeze into far less water than normal, making them easy pickings for eel packs. The eels simply have to find a pool full of fish, ambush them. In the high water season, prey would likely have a much better chance of keeping a safe distance and getting away, says co-author Carlos David Santana, a co-author and biologist of the Smithsonian Institution's National Museum of Natural History. The researchers don't know how this behavior evolved, how widespread it is, when it happens only during the low water season. But Santana has some thoughts on how the eels might pick out their groups, based on a straightforward individual level principle. Continue hunting with the same people when successful, the stable group eventually forms, this social predation may have developed. Most of the time, the eels rest at the bottom of the river, but at dawn and dusk, they moved to a shallow pool of the riverbank where they herd and shelter fish and launched joint attacks, mobilizing and devouring their prey. Each hunt usually took 2 hours and